Well, it, it's like your context about
you
it.
Know, really. We can't say it was a victory, but it did stop the Civil War in Greece. We didn't succeed in liberating Albania. Well, now you were in charge of the operations. You would know better than anybody why that happened.
Well, I didn't at the time. I know now, obviously. At the time, one had no idea what the hell gone wrong, but I didn't even know for about 2 years. I mean, the Foreign Office knew, obviously.
Mendime shumë të zellshme e të mira për me shkuë me vdekë për atë dheun tonë edhe nuk pes pare nuk I ipshemi pse po shkuëm me vdekë se e dishnami se jemi të vdekë për një qëllim e për një ide.
A very bad story what happened.
Totally story.
But I think what is almost more interesting is I mean, what our intentions were, what the British and American government's intentions were.
35 years ago, these three English gentlemen set out to bring down the government of another country. They were agents working for the British Secret Service, and their task was to try to change the balance of power in the world. But their plan was to go horribly wrong, and hundreds of people were to die in a remote country. To the world of the 1930s, Albania was a romantic, almost fictional place. Every New Year's Eve, its ruler, King Zog, held a ball in the country's capital, Tirana. In 1937, he invited a beautiful young Hungarian debutante to be his guest.
Met him in front of a whole crowd, about 3,000 people, of diplomats and all the dignitaries of Albania. I was so embarrassed that when he gave me a champagne glass, I let it fall. At that moment, the lights went out and everybody clapped their hands and I was in a terrible state of embarrassment. I thought him a wonderfully handsome man. So I fell in love.
It was a fairy tale wedding. Zog, who 12 years before had ruthlessly made himself king of a nation of warring tribes, now had the foundations of a dynasty, but it would only last for another year. Zog fled to exile in London, never to return. In 1944, a communist government led by Enver Hoxha took power, and Albania became a part of the new Soviet Empire.
From Stettin in the Baltic to Trieste in the Adriatic, an iron curtain has descended across the continent.
It was the start of the Cold War. Within 2 years, Berlin was blockaded, and a civil war with the communists raged in Greece.
That there is nothing they admire so much as strength.
Churchill spoke for those who feared that the Western Allies were drifting helplessly towards yet another world war, this time with Russia. The British Foreign Office decided to fight back, in secret. A Cold War committee was set up. Its job was to find ways of liberating the Soviet satellites by any means short of war. One of its members, Sir Ivan Kirkpatrick, had a brainwave. Would it not be possible, he said, to start a civil war in Albania, similar to the state of affairs the Russians had produced in Greece? The committee agreed and turned for help to a man who had fought undercover in Albania during the war.
I was approached one day by a friend of mine in the secret services who said, would I help them to set up the necessary organization to start a counter-revolution, I think is the right word, in Albania. And of course, I was glad to do so and spent the best part of a year helping them do it.
To the intelligence service, Albania was in the front line of the new threat from the east. The Russian Navy was building a submarine base there, just 50 miles from the Italian coast. It was to be a test case. If the Secret Service could engineer a counter-revolution in Albania, they could try the same thing elsewhere.
The situation was not like it is today, a rigid empire of the Soviets. It was much more fluid. And there did seem the possibility that if we took action, we could roll back the imperial tide from the east. And where better to start than a country which looked onto the sea and whose population I was convinced from my living with them, as I had for the best part of a year, would not be in the least likely to accept Soviet domination.
MI6, headed by Sir Stuart Menzies, turned to the Americans for help. In early 1949, an American intelligence agent was sent across to a meeting at MI6's headquarters in St. James's. The problem was how to ensure that a counter-revolution would produce the right government.
You can't attempt an operation like this unless you've got a political base. You can't just put people into a country and let them try it, do it on the scene, run around from village to village and so on. We'll try and form a government because it doesn't work that way. You've got to have an off-the-peg government to go in with, and you've got to have the propaganda to go in with it to say why people in the villages and the hills and the mountains and the plains should support this.
And Rome was rather fun. Our talks in Rome.
Amory and Lowe's first job was to create what would look like an independent Albanian government in exile. They gathered the refugee leaders together in Rome.
We wanted to keep it secret. And everybody thought you were Clark Gable. And we were surrounded.
Not anymore. The name would come up, and then no, it couldn't be, because we have a blood feud. My family has a blood feud with him. And no, it can't be, because he wouldn't be accepted, because he's too closely identified with the royalists, or he's too closely identified with something else, and so on. Interminable arguments. I mean, and I might add, the Albanians love talking.
Eventually, this committee was formed. Its head was Midhat Fresheri, the president of the Albanian Republican Movement. His deputy was to be Abbas Kupi, the leader of the royalist faction. If the communists were brought down, then these men would be invited in as the government, and no one would ever know that Britain and America had been behind them. Meanwhile, fighting men were selected from refugee camps in Italy, where thousands of exiled Albanians were living. At the same time, letters were sent out to ex-British soldiers from this house in Paddington. They offered a job in the Mediterranean and points east.
I received a letter from the Royal Marine Association indicating that there was a job in the Middle East that a chap with my type of training would be probably interested in. And that I responded to it, and eventually it turned out to be, MI6, wasn't it?
Lofty went for an interview with MI6. The job was landing small groups of armed men on a rocky coast at night, the very thing he had done in the war.
Did you jump at the job?
Yes, it was interesting, wasn't it?
What were you doing otherwise?
I'd only just come out of the service. I'd just about finished my leave.
And what was the alternative?
Well, I'd have to go to work, wouldn't I?
Next, MI6 needed a suitable boat. Two young Englishmen were building one in Athens.
This is a model of a Greek sailing caique, and the boat that we built looked, it was based on this. She looked exactly like a Greek sailing caique, the same rig, same hull, except underwater she was deeper. The job, anyway, was landing Albanian...
Refugees.
As they were. Putting them back into Albania, with the idea of fermenting some sort of a revolution.
The boat was called the Stormy Seas. The two yachtsmen agreed to the job and flew to London to be briefed.
As far as I remember, that's when they made us sign the Official Secrets Act. Another thing I remember being told, whether it was then or later, must have been then, I think, was that if we were unfortunate enough to be caught, we would talk. They said, therefore, the less you know, the better. Only know what you need to know, because if they get you, they'll make you talk.
The head of the American Secret Service is said to have once remarked, "Whenever we want to subvert any country, we always find that the British have an island within easy reach.
This is the entrance to the fort, which normally in the old days had a drawbridge when I lived here. And the moat down here was a firing range, because this is a place where we trained the men. It was army property when we were here, and it was a long way from the Fresh Pots. Valletta is away from any town or village, and it was chosen rarely because it was out of the way for security reasons.
The British part of the operation was to begin in the autumn of 1949. MI6 chose this fort in Malta as the secret base. Albanian fighters were to be trained and then taken home. Their task was to create havoc. The British agent appointed as military commander was an expert in subversion. He had just 4 months.
During that time, I had about 40 Albanians in all who came to this fort and put through the training which is required to send men into a hostile country.
Well, we was training them to use small arms and also so that they could get used to boats, being hopping in and out of boats, because they all lived in the mountains, and boat work and things of that nature were foreign to them.
Most of these men had been in camps in Germany and Italy, and they were poor chaps. They were, had no country, no future, and I think they volunteered because they hoped they would be able to eventually get back to their own country.
The Marines nicknamed the Albanians the Pixies because they were so small.
They were a bit sheep-like, really. They were all displaced persons and being kicked around from Libya to Italy and, from, you know, and I suppose that it was a meal ticket. They had everything to gain. And at that stage, live, as I say, living in DP camps, nothing to lose. And that's the basis of revolutions, isn't it?
Smiley and his wife had to live the double life of agents in the field. The cover supplied for them by MI6 was that of Deputy Commander of the Army Garrison and his lady wife.
Nobody knew what I was doing. And socially, I think we built up a fairly good reputation as going to parties. Polo I really enjoyed, and we had a very interesting time because Prince Philip was here at the time in the Navy, and our present Queen was then Duchess of Edinburgh, and she was here too. And as I say, it was a very gay and social life. Very often we'd go to a dinner party in dinner jackets. We dressed up in those days. Ladies wore hats when they went out and all that nonsense. And after dinner, we'd whistle up here and start working in an office here, which is deciphering signals, and I probably have to answer them or act on them and so on. And so we did lead a double life in that respect.
What was your social life like in Malta?
Well, we was working, you know, all during the week, more or less extended hours, and we just had one day off a week, went into Valletta for a couple of beers, and that was about the size of it.
But one large obstacle remained. King Zog, who now lived a lonely exile in Alexandria, without his blessing, none of the royalist guerrillas would fight.
We went on a journey to Alexandria to try to enlist the backing of King Zog, but realizing that the Republicans in Albania would be unlikely to accept his official leadership, and the Americans anyway weren't very keen on King.
We flew down there and we went to this villa outside of Cairo where Zog was living at that time, and then explained to Zog what we were trying to do, and to save his feelings, we told him that we didn't think it was the moment to try to put a royalist government back. They'd gone out of fashion a bit in the Balkans.
They wanted to make a kind of a free Europe, free Albanian committee, which would be recognized by everybody, like a government in exile, because most of our government in exile was dead. And my husband answered, there's one thing that a king cannot do. My kingly duties and responsibilities, I cannot give over to any kind of committee or to any kind of man. And so he was very angry. He wasn't well. And he really told me that they should leave the room.
They left and allowed Zog to sleep on their proposals. They returned the next day.
Julian put it to him beautifully. I mean, Julian was just wonderful. And he said, Highness, can we depend on you not to oppose anything we're doing? Will you help us for the sake of your country? And Zog agreed. He said, yes, I won't necessarily do everything to help you, but I will do nothing to oppose what you're doing or to try and put a spanner in your works. He didn't put that in Albanian, but that's what he was saying.
Why did King Zog trust the British and the Americans then?
I don't know if he trusted, but I don't know. I think rather he hoped. After all, they were against communism, weren't they? At least they were supposed to be.
He was the only head of state, whether king, president, or what have you, who, when an assassin took a shot at him, fired back. And it happened at the Vienna Opera House, where he'd gone on a state visit. When he'd gone on a state visit to Austria, he stepped out of his carriage, and from one of the columns or at the entrance to the Opera House, an assassin started blazing away with him with a pistol. So Zog, instead of falling mortally wounded to the ground or jumping back, fell into the gutter for cover, whipped out a pistol and started shooting back at the assassin. It's the only time in history it's ever happened that a head of state has fired back. And I thought it was terrific, very Balkan, because obviously he wouldn't move. He wouldn't be dressed for the evening if he hadn't had his gun with him.
The military preparations went on. The stormy seas slipped into Malta. Leatham and Barclay waited to be contacted.
Our telephone calls had to be made away from where we were living, in a telephone box, so they couldn't be, I don't know, bugged. And do you remember that strange man? I don't know who he is even now, but we had to meet him at the 6 mile stone outside Valletta on the way to Rabat. And we got in this bus, a baking hot day, and more or less desert, you know. And we were counting the milestones as we went along. The sixth one, we stopped the bus and got out. And there was a man wiping the dust off the 6 mile stone, you see, looking in the opposite direction, of course, when we got off the bus. So we had to look in the opposite direction too, while he walked off in the middle of the field, the bus got on the way. But the whole setup was so laughable. It was like the most stupid James Bond film. It was quite unreal.
We were playing sort of cops and robbers,
absolutely,
really, most again, of the time.
Yeah.
On the 4th of September, the Albanian committee arrived in London. They stayed in the Barclay Hotel. They visited the studios of the BBC World Service. Their leader, Midhat Frashëri, was given a 15-minute broadcast to Albania. It was transmitted at 4 p.m. It was never heard. Unfortunately, electricity was not switched on in Albania until 6. It was at this stage that a new figure joined the team. A rising young star in MI6 had been promoted to the job of representing the intelligence services in Washington. He spent September 1949 being briefed about the details of the Albania operation. His name was Kim Philby. He then traveled to Washington to take up his post.
When Philby got into place and so on, it was agreed that the operational command of the operation was a joint one, shared by Philby and myself when we were together. Philby was a great charmer. He came to us with an enormous reputation. And here was a man who had very considerable experience, but in addition had something that appealed to Americans, which was that he was known as a Young Turk. That is to say, he had produced a revolution within the British service in which it advanced his own career and so on. And the American bureaucracy sometimes admires that kind of thing. And so he came with this enormous reputation and turned out to be, as I say, a man of very great charm. He seemed to be discreet. One had the feeling that one could have confidence in him.
The committee, Albania's government in waiting, had also traveled to America to publicize their cause. They were installed in the Lexington Hotel in New York, paid for by the CIA. But then, at the end of September, an event occurred that shocked and frightened both the British and American governments. The Soviet Union exploded their first atomic bomb.
In Washington, the foreign ministers of the 12th Atlantic...
Hitting back at the Russians was now more important than ever. Dean Acheson, the U.S. Secretary of State, met Ernest Bevin in secret after this NATO meeting. They gave the final go-ahead to the first landings. But a few days later, the operation suffered a major setback.
I got a phone call from the New York City police. Said, there's a man dead in the Hotel Lexington here in New York. And we don't know who he is. He's got a funny passport we've never seen before. And there are two or three of, we don't know if they're his relatives or what they are, in his room, screaming in a way, in a language we can't figure out what it is. See, but we found a slip of paper in his pocket that has your name and the New York telephone number. So we want you to come down here right away. So I had to go down as fast as I could. And I got in the room, and there was poor old Midhead. And he was on the bed, and he was dead as he could be. The room was in absolute chaos, because these three Albanians, they were screaming. He told us he had gold sovereigns, and they're not here in the room. You stole them. No, you stole them. You stole them. And they went on arguing and arguing and so on. In the meantime, the New York police are getting more. And they said, what do you got to do? Are you one of these Albanians, too? I said, no, I'm not an Albanian. I said, I'm with the State Department. It's the best thing to say under the circumstances. So he said, well, we got to take him away to the medical examiner's office. So I said, take him away. Then I got a hold of these guys and said, now listen, stop arguing about these sovereigns, whichever one of you took them, I couldn't care less. Here's some money to bury him with. Fortunately, I had some money with me because I wanted to put up, I didn't want him to go to Potter's Field, you know, I wanted to at least get a decent, he'd come there for us and so poor old boy.
Frashëri had died from a massive and unexplained heart attack. The government in exile fell apart. There was now no political base to the operation. But it was too late to change anything. At exactly the same time as the would-be Albanian president lay dying in this room, a British naval motorboat had left Malta with two groups of Albanians on board. They were to rendezvous in secret with the stormy seas. For Britain and America, the Cold War was now no longer a political battle. They were about to invade an outpost of the Soviet Empire. Stormy Seas was heading for the mountainous coastline of southern Albania. This is 8mm film shot secretly this year of the very place the Albanians were to land. Leatham and Barclay were now on their own. All they had to do was find the landing beach that MI6 had codenamed Sea View.
We went over by night to Albania and pitch dark, no moon, anything like that. and it needed rather skillful navigation. I don't now remember how we picked up the just one
landing beach.
Landing beach. Well, there were just mountains, you know, high black mountains, jagged peaks, and you could just see ravines coming down. But as to which was the ravine we might be going for, when we got in close to the shore, there was a big swell coming in, oily calm, no wind, no moon, and the swell rolling into the shore, and you could see the clouds going by overhead fast. And down low, there was no wind at all.
The stormy seas lay 200 yards off the coast. The Albanians were transferred to a small boat and taken in by Marines.
When we was more or less about 200 or 300 yards off the beach, there was a light came up because it was a fairly steep to rocky terrain like Cornwall. And one of the pixies saw it, you see, as well. It was oblong, like a door. The door had opened. So of course I thought to myself, watched it for a bit, and it closed. So of course there's 1,000 thoughts in your head. You're right on the threshold, you know. And so I thought, well, probably somebody put the cat out, or stepped outside for a leak, and so we pushed on, unloaded the pixies, and went back for the others. And of course, when we got back in again, they were still at the bottom of this ravine, grouped together, sort of huddled up. So I opt out and said, I went up and said, well, you know, because I couldn't see much point in hanging about. So they all just mooched off.
Within hours, this group was ambushed by Albanian security forces. These three men were killed immediately. The other group ventured into villages, only to be told that a few days before, the Albanian army had sealed off the area. Meanwhile, Smiley and his staff had moved to a large villa on the island of Corfu, 3 miles from the Albanian coast. They waited there for radio messages from the guerrillas.
They did come up, some of them. They didn't all come up on the air as quickly as we'd like, and in fact, some didn't come up at all. They were obviously clobbered before they could, but those who did come up gave news that they were probably expected because they had met opposition, which we didn't expect them to meet. We expect them to land and just trail over the mountains to their home areas, so to speak.
6 days later, the stormy seas landed more groups. Again, they found the hills crawling with soldiers. There was little they could do. The men began to straggle across the border to Greece.
When the first lot of men came out, they were debriefed, not by me, but they definitely said they had been, no doubt about it, they'd been expected. And I went back with the worry that there'd either been a traitor or a colossal breach of security. When I say a traitor, I mean one of us here, a mole, as we like to call it these days. There might have been somebody here either was double-crossing us, or there had been a bad breach of security, which I couldn't believe, because we kept security here very tight, and it worked extremely well. We'd sent these poor men literally to their deaths, and we'd let them down very badly somehow, and I didn't know how or who.
There were hurried late-night conferences at MI6 headquarters between the British and Americans. Something was going wrong. The question was whether it was just bad luck.
Well, we know now it wasn't bad luck, but at the time we didn't know. The bad luck consisted of Kim Philby. He was reading all the messages I was sending to Washington about what was happening in the operation, and also he was getting information from the British embassy side as well. And he was probably, he was definitely trotting around to the Soviet embassy, giving him all the details. That's how they were going in the bag, but we didn't know it at that moment.
Undeterred, the next year, 1950, the Americans planned their subversion. 250 Albanian exiles were chosen and taken to a military camp near Munich. The United States Army knew them only as Company 4000, a labor battalion. The pattern was the same as for Malta. Small groups were trained, often at night, in how to bring down a government. Meanwhile, Kim Philby went about his business in Washington. Parties at his house in Nebraska Avenue soon became the center of social life for the American intelligence world.
They were long and very, very wet. And we all drank. That's not a reproach to Philby. I do understand that Philby really at certain points drank things that people simply don't drink, like, the mouthwash and so on, that kind of thing. But mind you, at that period, we really were all afloat on a sea of drink. Everyone drank their way through the Second World War. And they had to. I mean, people in the United Kingdom were under such terrible stress that it was, and this is common to all wars and so on. The habit went on afterwards. And since Philby enjoyed it himself and so on, and we all had the habit, but at that time we were all in our 20s, you know, and at the oldest in our early 30s. And this is part of life at that time.
Well, you had everybody fooled here, in Washington, everywhere. And he certainly had me fooled, too, because never in his cups did he ever give anything away that one might have said something suspicious about him. Not at all.
On the night of November the 19th, 1950, the Americans began their attacks on the government of Albania. An unmarked plane flew over the north of the country. One group was dropped by parachute here in the Mati region. At daybreak, they saw soldiers combing the hills.
Edhe kemi dalë me një kodër në pyjet edhe kemi zënë katër dollinja aty. E shish na ushtrin ka dilte okolla edhe na automatikin e kemi pa në dorë edhe kalosh na një ushtar o civil o ushtar e kaloshin fët për desh zoti, edhe nuk na pa. Edhe mas atyne, na vetëm qi.
For 3 days and nights, the group hid under leaves in the forest. Finally, in desperation, they ventured into the village below.
Po mas anë e pa me dhe të vërtetën, se na lemre popli, që ju u kanë ditë se ju do të vini edhe minutin këto. Se do të vini në minutin kur vini ju. E në ushtria akon në fushën e degës e lemruume, e to na prit në atë minutin që na të zbritëshim. Po na për fat, ratëm gabimisht, ratëm në malet e krumës, se na të këshina para në fushë degës në vendin e caktum, ishin të na prit të hava, burrë, me parashrupë, në cofë në tofë.
Another group were dropped further south in the Martinez region.
Kam hecur një adhet hapa, po heqëm keqër, ishem ran, kishem municion shumë. Tu hecur, veç kur ka kesh pushka. E u kanë vika ata, u binju dhe versant të vebre. Mu, s'ka shku e gjatë, më kara një pushka. Në kam një majtë, edhe më ka gëdo një sakë këtu një, unë kishem me thënë një 5 metre, po këdi ma pak nështë, 3 metre, 4 metre, më ka fuqë. Po më ka fuqë për para. Edhe kur këmë thkje, pa hiqë s'këmë gjëllinët, dhe se unë dhenjë kama. Kur shikoj, gjak i shkon të krua.
Atë ditë kemi luftue, edhe neset këmë shkua të shpia. Të shpia jeme, natën këmë shkua. Edhe këmë takua nana. Nana më tha gjitë ke lip këtu. Tha ke gabua shumë që ke ardhë, se kam edhe 4 djem tjerë. Tha shtë të 4 le shkua në natë. Unë i 4, ato 3 le shkua në edhe une. Tha orë birë, tha, mas si ke hinë kësoj rrugë, tha fishekin e mram, tha rruje edhe biri vete, shtik e i gjallë mos bjendoj.
Night after night, the Americans flew a plane over Albania waiting for radio messages from the groups, but none came. The British had also run more groups in from Malta. News of their fate began to filter back.
Two of the members of a group of, I think, either four or five, had been caught in Korcha, which is in the southern half of the country, and that as an example, they were tied behind a car and driven through the streets until they died.
And then, on May the 25th, 1951, two British traitors, Guy Burgess and Donald Maclean, defected to Moscow. Philby was immediately recalled to London on a suspicion of being the third man who had helped them escape. But despite this, the Americans persisted. A month later, this group was dropped into the Loshnia region in northern Albania.
I remember where we said goodbye to that friends that day in 1951. So they go on the mission. And we hear after 4 months, they was dropped in Albania. And after that, we hear that they was killed, all of them. Every one of them was, they fight as 5 or 6 or 8 hours, I don't know, until they have no more, anything left to fight in. And after that, they burned themselves. They burned the house and themselves inside.
They burned themselves to
That's
death?
That's right, yeah, to death. Four of them.
Why did they do that?
They don't want to be caught by the communists alive.
What would have happened to them if they had been captured?
They're going
to
be killed anyway.
If they were dropped, they were practically waiting with a net to pick them up. Or if they went in by sea, they were hiding behind sand dunes or trees. I mean, the moment they got ashore, or the moment their feet touched the ground, there were Albanian security people waiting for them. And it was, we were convinced about the leak. There was no question. Who it was another matter, but at that moment. But it had to be a leak because they couldn't be that lucky the Albanian security people that lucky all the time. Once in a while it might have been by chance or whatnot, but all the missions that we were sending in being picked up, it was too much. It just had to be a leak.
It was to get worse. In October, Radio Tirana began to broadcast from this cinema a mass trial of captured guerrillas. The government showed photographs of their equipment, their guns, explosive devices, codes, and even American tinned food. To the world outside at the time, it sounded like any other communist show trial, full of hysterical allegations of secret American attempts to subvert Albania. But it was all true. The whole basis of the operation had been blown. Even while the trial was actually in progress, another group was dropped here. Within hours, they were surrounded by soldiers with machine guns and mortars.
I think by this stage, they may well have decided that the liberation of Albania was not on, but that there were other compelling reasons for continuing. It was important to be seen to be retaliating against Stalin's aggressive moves in Czechoslovakia, in Berlin, in Greece. But then, of course, the original objective, liberation of Albania, was lost sight of. And the Albanian volunteers, who'd been led to believe that Britain and the United States were trying to help them to liberate their country, were to that extent deceived.
The camp at Malta was closed down. The British had pulled out. But the Americans refused to give in. They had yet another plan to bring down the Hoxha regime. The key was King Zog. In August 1951, Zog flew to New York. He bought this estate on Long Island, reputedly with a bucket of jewels. Today, it is a ruin. In fact, the CIA paid for the estate. In return, they wanted the reluctant Zog's cooperation. They outlined a plan. An agent within Albania had brought news that a group of senior army officers were ready to move against the communist regime. All they wanted was a sign that the Americans would support them. The CIA asked Zog to allow some of his bodyguard to be sent secretly into Albania to contact the officers. Reluctantly, he agreed.
They each got a bag of gold. So it wasn't Americans, it was king himself. And the king told me, I'm afraid I'll never see them again.
Zog sent four of his closest aides. Amongst them was Captain Zenil, who had been Queen Geraldine's bodyguard since the wedding. They were taken secretly from Alexandria to Paris, where they stayed in this hotel. Then, one night, a car driven by an American agent picked them up. They were driven across the border to Germany and flown from there to Greece. All hopes now rested with these four men. For 3 years, group after group had been captured or killed. This was a last desperate attempt to bring down the regime. It just had to work. On April the 27th, 1952, the four officers crossed the border into Albania. Zog's Royal Guard was returning home.
Reassuring messages came from Albania to the Americans that everything was going well. They were recruiting agents, they were storing equipment, and they were getting ready to recruit more officers and eventually rise up and throw out the communists. So reinforcements were sent in, more agents, equipment was dropped. This went on for more than a year. And then suddenly there was this bombshell at the end of 1953 when the radio announced that all these people were under arrest, indeed that most of them had been under arrest for many months, that all the messages had been intercepted and sent under communist control, and that the whole thing indeed was a plant, and that was the end of it all.
Their show trial was also broadcast. The royal household listened in Alexandria.
And then Zenel spoke. We heard his voice. And at the end of it, what he said, he called out, I am forced, and then it was finished. So everything he said had been forced. And then they killed him. They were all killed. And the families who had taken them in. That's why it was a very tragic, horrible story. It was unnecessary. I think that if men go and sacrifice their lives, at least it should be, if it's a failure, but it shouldn't mean the death of so many other people. And a failure by betrayal is one of the most catastrophic things that can happen. They were betrayed.
Could you ever forgive a man who betrayed that many people?
No, I certainly will not forgive that Philby man. Isn't he dead? He's still alive? Who died? Are the other ones?
I'd say, technically, in the business, he was tremendous. I mean, you know, considering he was a double agent, a brilliant double agent. You can't deny that. Look what he did. If I were in Moscow and ran into him in the street outside the Inn Tourist Hotel or something, which isn't very likely that I'll be there, and he passed me, I wouldn't resist the temptation to say hello, Kim. I wouldn't say, you son of a bitch. I say, how do you like living in Moscow? It's a strange thing, you know? I mean, morally, as I say, traitor. So, not for me. No admiration that way. But technically, it was amazing that he could have infiltrated the way he did for the people he was working for. Absolutely amazing. I mean, he must be the shining example of the KGB school. See what you can do if you try. Yeah.
2 years later, Philby was publicly accused of being the third man.
Philby, on the right, holds a press conference to deny charges that he was involved in the disappearance of Burgess and McLean.
Well, if there was a third man, were you, in fact, the third man?
No, I was not.
You think there was one?
No comment.
In 1963, Philby fled to Moscow. Since then, successive governments have always denied that the Albania operation took place. Philby's role made it too embarrassing. But there are still those who thought it was the right thing to do at the time.
It was an exciting business, and we expected it to be exciting. It was interesting. And it was meant to be, you know, we thought it was worthwhile. It was, if it had gone right, you could say we would have liberated another country, or helped to. From an oppressor, because Hoxha still is, I suppose, is a very oppressive regime. Whether, in retrospect, King Zog would have been the better, we don't know. At that time, he thought he would. Yeah. It's a continuation of what we've been doing during the war, after all. And then everybody thought it was all right.
Now, we're not entitled to go around the world abolishing tyrannies, but when those tyrannies impinge on our own interests in our own future, then we have to defend ourselves. This was the case of the Germans. It then became the case of the Russians. But the Russian approach has been going on for centuries, and we're now face to face with it all over the world.
Med deshiren ton, përmishli rua at dhe, përmishli rua at popull prej komunizmit, ne dishimi se kemi englisht e Amerikan mrapa. Po në realitet, kena kon falsa je. Ne na pahan pachua vetëm se për buje, vetëm se për
I don't justify the Albanian operation or any of these other things on the grounds that the Russians are communists. I justify it on the grounds that the Russian state is a menace to the peace of the world.
And the Albania operation was one battle in that long fight?
An episode. An episode in the long fight.
An unhappy episode or a happy episode?
There is no happiness or unhappiness in foreign relations.
I feel very sad, to be quite frank. I think, looking back on it, knowing the result, it's just heartbreaking. I can't think any sort of words to describe it, really, but I mean, if you were in a responsible position and you were sending men, you didn't know it then, but literally sending men to their deaths, it's a pretty horrible feeling, to say the least, in retrospect.
Tell me, looking back at the operation all those years ago, well, what do you think about what happened? What do you feel about it?
Well, too bad.